morning I want to continue on. We started last week looking at this question, of course, based on a very famous Christmas carol that we just sang a moment ago. What child is this? This child who was born over some 2,000 years ago in a stable, in a manger, to parents of very lowly estate, very obscure people, to a young teenage woman who God specifically chose, who was blessed by God to be able to be the mother of the birth of our Lord and Savior. This child conceived by the Holy Spirit. This child whose birth we celebrate in just a little over 2 weeks, and who we should celebrate this birth each and every single day of our life, and not just on December 25th. And so we look at this question and reminded of this question, what child is this? And you may sit there and think, well, Karl, you know, why is this even important? I mean, we all know who Jesus is. We all know he was born in a manger. We all know he was born in a stable. We all know that Joseph and Mary was his mother and was his father. But why is this even important to even consider last week and this week and again next week? Well, this is why I believe it's important. Because there are many, many people out there, they know who Jesus is in their heads. You can ask probably most people in America today, do you believe that a man named Jesus existed? And the answer you will more than likely get will be yes. Amen. They know who Jesus was in their head. But the reason why it's important that we be reminded, or maybe some of you today for the very first time realize exactly who this child is, who this child Jesus is because it's not enough to know it in our heads. We need to know it in here in our hearts. That's what makes the difference. When we know it in our hearts, then it changes our lives. And that's why it's important. Today, last week, we looked at this Jesus, this child, is God. God made flesh. He came to live and dwell among us, as the first chapter of the Gospel of John says. Today, we see that this child, this Jesus, is King. And I get excited when I think about this, and you know why? Because no matter what type of governments are in place, whether it's in America, whether it's any country in the world, first of all, God put those governments and authority in place. And we're told so in Scripture, that is true. God put them in place. And because God put them in place, that means that ultimately God, Jesus Christ, is King. He is authority over all. Jesus even said himself, all authority has been given to me under heaven and in the earth. And Jesus is King, and that's what I want us to see today. He's not just a king, but he is the King of Kings. Remind you of the words, again, the very famous Christmas carol. Hark, the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild. God and sinners reconciled. That's this child. That's this King that we're going to see today. In the Old Testament book of 1 Chronicles, probably not a very common book in Scripture used for a Christmas message. But I want us to look at today, here is during the reign, the time of King David, and Nathan the prophet comes to David with this prophecy. And this is what I want us to look at so that we can see exactly what this passage says about Jesus, this child being king. And if you look at the 17th chapter of 1 Chronicles, beginning in the 11th verse, Nathan brings this message to David from God. He says to David, when your days are over and you go to be with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, one of your own sons, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for me, and I will establish his throne forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son, and I will never take my love away from him as I took it away from your predecessor. I will set him over my house and my kingdom forever, and his throne will be established forever. Here's the first thing this passage says about Jesus is king. First of all, this king comes through a promise. The God of Scriptures, the creator of the universe that this book tells us about from beginning in the first chapter of Genesis all the way through Revelation, is a God of promise. I mean, you look all through Scripture. He is a God of promise, not of what's going to happen today, but he is a God of promise of what will happen in the future. He is a God of promise of hope. He is a God of promise of assurance. And he is true to his promise, and all of his promises have been and will be fulfilled. Because God is faithful. At the very beginning of Scripture, he established his promise, his covenant, if you will, to Abraham. Then to Abraham's son Isaac. And then to Isaac's son Jacob. And then on down to Noah. All the way up to, we see here again, him establishing this promise or his covenant with David, this king that God specifically chose to reign over his people, and that through whose lineage, whose ancestry, ultimately Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, would come. Which basically means that all of these promises, all of these covenants that God established with his people, ultimately point to one person. They all point to Jesus. This King of Kings, this Lord of Lords. If you look at Matthew chapter 1, it starts off with the genealogy, the family record of Jesus. It says that the record of the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah says, the son of David, the son of Abraham. It first mentions again, Jesus was descended from David. This king that's referred to as a man after God's own heart. Also says Jesus was descended from Abraham. We'll see in just a few moments, another thing this passage says about Jesus is that this king comes through people. Comes through people. But in verse 11 of this 17th chapter of 1 Chronicles, David is told here by Nathan the prophet that God tells David, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, one of your own sons. Now this sort of has a double meaning here. Certainly it's speaking about David's earthly son, Solomon. And of course we know in the Old Testament that Solomon ultimately built the temple, the house of the Lord that David longed to build, but he never was given that opportunity. He was not able to see that fulfilled. But his son Solomon did. Son Solomon did. But the other meaning we see is more of an eternal meaning, more of a divine meaning, ultimately through Jesus Christ. You see, through David, and then Solomon and son, and down the line to Jesus, would God's eternal kingdom be established. Through David, then Solomon, and down the line to Jesus again, would God's eternal kingdom be the government of all forevermore. Just as Isaiah the prophet wrote. He says again from God, for a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest upon his shoulders. Now that word rest has the idea of coming to settle upon. It's a word that means permanent. Established forever. That's what that word rest means. And it says, and the government will rest upon this son, upon this child born to us, on his shoulders. And it says, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father. Again, reference again, as we saw last week, that this child is God, and Prince of Peace. That this child is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And then Isaiah goes on to say that there will be no end to the increase of his government or of peace. One day, this is our hope, folks. One day, Isaiah says here, there will be no end to the increase of peace. Because Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, will be on the throne, is on the throne, and will reign forever and ever for all eternity. And then he goes on to say, on the throne of David, over his kingdom, to establish it, to uphold it with justice and righteousness. From then on and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. Again, another promise that has been fulfilled and will be fulfilled. But this promise, this covenant of God to establish his kingdom through Christ, it's not just given to David alone. Listen to what Paul writes in Galatians, the third chapter. He says, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. In order that in Christ Jesus, the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we would receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. You see, this covenant, this promise that we see this king coming from God, is not just to David, it's to you, it's to me. That the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles. Certainly it first came to the Jews, but now it has been available to the Gentiles, to you and me. That we would receive the promise of God's Holy Spirit within us, to dwell within us through faith in this King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And then he goes on to say, Paul says in Galatians, now the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. He does not say, and to seeds, plural, referring to many, but rather to one. And to your seed, that is Christ. See, this promise of an eternal king, of an eternal kingdom, is through Abraham's seed, singular, ultimately Jesus Christ is king. So Nathan the prophet tells King David that God will establish Christ as eternal king through promise, through a promise that God was faithful to fulfill. And here's the second part I mentioned just a moment ago. This king comes through people. Again, in verse 11 of the 17th chapter of Chronicles, Nathan tells David, he says, I will raise up your offspring, one of your own sons. David was an ordinary human being, flesh and blood, just like you and I are. But if you look back in Matthew chapter 1, and this is what is so intriguing to me about God and His plan for redemption and for a Savior. If you look back at the record of those people in the line of Jesus Christ, this King of Kings, it's hard to believe that God would choose some of those. I mean, think about this. First of all, you had Abraham, you had Isaac, you had Jacob, who really, he was a cheat, he was a swindler, he was a con man. But he was given the name Israel. The beginning of the nation, God's chosen nation, chosen people. Then you had Joseph, Jacob's youngest son. He would be a great example of godliness. He would resist temptation of adultery with his boss's wife while living in Egyptian captivity. You had Judah, another one of Jacob's sons, who was deceived by his daughter-in-law into thinking that she was a prostitute, gave into that temptation. She became pregnant. They had a son by the name of Perez, another ancestor of Jesus who was born out of immorality. Then you had Ruth and Boaz. And some of you might think, well, what was wrong with Ruth and Boaz? They were good people. Well, they were good people. But Ruth was a Moabite. Boaz was a Jew. In God's law to Moses, it specifically forbid God's people, the Israelites, to intermarry with anybody outside of their people. And Ruth was a Moabite. Boaz and Ruth get married. The only reason why Boaz married Ruth, why she was included, was by marriage. Look at Saul, Israel's first king, chosen only by the people of Israel. You know why they wanted Saul as their first king? You really know why? Huh? He was tall, dark, and handsome. He looked good. This man looks like a king. Have we not seen throughout history what can happen when we start picking our leaders based on looks and appearance? That's what happened here. That's what happened with Saul. But he was only chosen because the people insisted on having a king to rule over them. You know why? Because all the other nations have one. We want one too. But ultimately, Saul was a man who just went absolutely crazy. Then there was David, a young shepherd boy. Works in a field, tends sheep, takes care of sheep. Ultimately would become a murderer, would become an adulterer, but yet again a man who was referred to as a man after God's own heart. And then to David's son, Solomon, whose power and whose wealth, certainly he would build the temple of the Lord. Solomon started out really good, but the more power and the more wealth and the more women that he got a hold of, he ultimately got the big head. He lost his way in many ways. These are people for whom the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, would come. What an example of God's goodness and of God's mercy. People who were absolutely spiritually and divinely unqualified to be in the human lineage of Christ, the King of Kings. But look at verse 13 in 1 Chronicles. Here he said, I will be his father, he will be my son, and I will never take my love away from him. People, as I read that today, I am so glad that God did not choose me because I was the best and the brightest. I would have failed miserably there. But because like you, and these in the lineage of David, these few that I mentioned, I am the least of these to even be chosen to be in a relationship with Christ. I'm so glad God didn't choose me because of my strength, which I don't have very much of. But he chose me in spite of my weaknesses. I'm so glad God didn't choose me because of my self-righteousness. In my mind, I'm a very good person. I try to do a lot of good things. I try to help people. But God didn't choose me because of what I think about myself. God chose me because of my unrighteousness, because of my need for a Savior, so that the righteousness from God through faith in Christ would come to me and to all who believe. From Romans 3:22. You see, not all of Jesus' ancestry were kings or queens. But the fact is, God chose through uncommon, undeserving people to fulfill his plan for this eternal King, his only Son, Jesus Christ. Here's the third, last thing. This King comes through providence. If you look at this passage, you see the words of God's providential plan. And God's plan wasn't just thought of as history moved along. God's providential plan was set and established from before the foundations of creation, before the foundation of the world. But look at this verse, this chapter in 1 Chronicles, these verses we read, indications of God's providence in this. He says, I will establish his kingdom in verse 11. He says in verse 12, he will build a house for me. I will establish his throne forever. In verse 14, he says, I will set him over my house and my kingdom, and his throne will be established forever. Let me ask you a question this morning. When we have seen how God is true to his word and how he fulfills his promises to his people, why is it we still go through periods of doubt in our lives? Why is it when we're faced with some difficulty or tragic circumstance in life, we look to God and we say, God, I don't know if I can make it through it. You know what you're really saying there? God, I don't know if you can bring it through. Why is it when we're faced with financial difficulties, we look at God and we say, God, why did you do this to me? In other words, what we're saying is, God, you don't really have a whole lot of love for me if you're going to make me suffer financially or health-wise or whatever reason. If God, if we truly believe in our heart and our soul that God is true to his promises and God is faithful and his word is true and will be fulfilled, why is it we still go through those periods of doubt? You know, we sing that hymn, and I just thought about it. Actually, it just came to my mind. Standing on the promises of Christ my King. Through eternal ages, let His praises ring. I can't remember the rest right now off the top of my head, but you know it. Even when man, all through history, and still continues today to unsuccessfully thwart the providential plans of God, His plan of mercy, His plan of grace, He has preserved. And that mercy and grace is still in place and still available today. See, God's eternal kingdom. His eternal King of Kings, Jesus Christ, comes through promise, comes through an undeserved human race, comes through His certain and assured providence. And there is coming a day before this King of Kings and Lord of Lords, where every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So what child is this? This child that Thursday, 2 weeks away, we're going to gather around our trees, we're going to gather with our family, and we're going to celebrate the birth of this child. What child is this? He is King. And the question for you today is, will you submit and surrender to the King of Kings as your personal Lord and Savior? That's just the plain and simple question. Will you bow before Him and will you confess Him now as the ultimate supreme authority in your life? You know, each and every person, we have two choices. Either humbly come before Him and bow before this King of Kings, or to refuse to come before Him and to refuse to bow before Him out of our pride, out of our self-righteousness. But we just read from Scripture where it says, one day, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. And whether you choose to bow now, or whether you refuse not to, one day we all will. And there will be no other choice. There will be no other option. Hark the herald angels sing. Glory to this newborn.